Wir kommen zu unserem nächsten Gast. Er ist Autor des Buches Robots Will Steal Your Jobs, But It's Okay. His keynote will be in English, so that's why we are switching into English. He's not only an author and researcher, but also a renowned speaker, focusing on future challenges of humankind, such as technology, unemployment, and education. He is himself a superstar in the new work field. Yes, you are. So he will talk all about the superstar economy and the future of work today. Please welcome and give a warm welcome to the CEO of Deep Thought and founder of Visionary, a think tank focused on the future of technology and society. He is Federico Pistono. Welcome. Stage is yours.
Thank you.
Roboter stehlen meinen Job, aber das ist okay. Die Superstar-Economy ist eher das Problem. Glaub an das Gute in der Maschine. Und wenn du willst, dann siehst du ihn auf YouTube wieder.
Nice. Guten Tag, Berlin. I'll be speaking in English because, I don't speak German yet. But I'll try to give you perspective today. I'll be speaking about this thing, disruption. Now, when I say disruption, how many here, raise your hand if you do, have a good idea, have a good picture in their mind of what disruption is right now? Okay. I hope it's not what Google Images suggest, because these are like meaningless stock images that don't mean anything. My image when I think of disruption is this one. So as you can see from this highly detailed and scientific graph, you've got human progress on, that was a joke by the way, you've got human progress on the y-axis and time on the x-axis. And you've got improvement over time. Now you're standing there and you think, wow, I've done so much, right? You've like quintupled the rate of improvement over time. And you're thinking, this is a game changer. Like, this is going very, very high in the future. But this is what disruption looks like to me. And we are standing pretty much at the beginning of that knee, the curve that shoots up like that. And I've started to really think and breathe and do disruption when I went to Singularity University 5 years ago, which is at the NASA Ames Research Park in Silicon Valley, Mountain View in California. And it's an institution started by this gentleman here, Ray Kurzweil, who's now the director of engineering at Google, and Peter Diamandis, that you can see here flying in space with Tony Stark, and James Cameron. Of course, Peter told me that he's much more proud of the picture on the right, but don't tell Elon Musk, please. So this is disruption to me. And in practice, I've put these thoughts in a book, which is also available in German, but I can't say the name in German, sorry. But you can find it. And it talks about technological employment. Now, that's the idea that in the future, we are going to see something radically different in the landscape of jobs and the workforce. In particular, this. So we got a bunch of jobs today. Now, there are two ways that you can think about the future. One way is to think that you've got old jobs that are being replaced by a huge wave of innovation. You've got new jobs that are created as a result of this new innovation. For example, when we destroyed almost 95% of agricultural jobs were destroyed, but that did not create a structural problem in society because we created new opportunities. We have service industry. I mean, Xing is an example of something that didn't exist 50 years ago and couldn't have existed. So this is one picture of kind of a cyclical cycle of you destroy jobs, you create new technology, and you have new jobs. But then there is a very different picture, which is this one. So you are shrinking the size of the available workforce. Now, the economic output stays the same or actually even grows, But the vast majority of jobs that are being destroyed are not replaced by new jobs. There is very, very few jobs that are being created as a result. So you've got two different philosophies, and nobody knows who is going to be right. So you can think of it as it's the same old story that happened before, Industrial Revolution and blah, 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 or this time is different. Who here believes that it's the same old story? Raise your hand. Wow. Okay, so I've been giving talks like this, similar, for the past 7 years. And 7 years ago, when I presented this, 95% of hands were, it's the same old story. Now there were two people, and it's 700 of you or something. So something has changed, and people are thinking about these things differently. In fact, later today, there will be Carl Benedict Frey, who's one of the researchers who presented a study, which now became almost seminal in the field, that predict that 47% of jobs will be destroyed in the United States within the next 20 years. And that's interesting because I wrote a book 2 years before the paper was published that had exactly the same results, but I know they didn't copy my book because they used a different methodology, and probably they weren't even aware of my book. So through different means, we came to exactly the same conclusion. So that's a smoking gun for me, because the methodology is quite complicated, but it can be summarized in a very simple way. Imagine that it's true that new technologies destroy jobs, but also create new ones, just as many or even more. If that's true, then in the last 50 years, we should have occupations that didn't exist before, that now exist, that employ a lot of people. Does that make sense? No? Right? Makes sense, that it should create new kinds of jobs. So I took the list of all the jobs, occupations, listed by the number of people that are employed. This is the US, but you can do the same in Europe, and the numbers come out pretty much the same in relative proportions. So you've got transportation, retail, and say, all right, how far down do you have to go before you find a job that didn't exist 50 years ago? You have to go number 33, computer programmers, which is only 1 million people. Now, you take all of these, the ones that are before that, the 32 job occupations before, and they employ about 50% of the workforce. Now, of course, there is some overlap. Some jobs will be repurposed by learning new skills, so applying the same kind of job to a new technology. And there are some jobs in the lower part that do persist or that are destroyed. So you've got almost these proportions. But this gives you an order of magnitude of the size that we're talking about. So what's going on here? Why is this happening? But business is changing really fast. How fast? Well, 89% of Fortune 500 companies that were in existence in 1955 didn't exist in 2014. 89%. And in the next 10 years, it's predicted that 40% of the S&P 500 will not be in the list anymore. Now, this is real fast change, and the reason is that the competency that you have will become obsolete very soon. If you knew how to do a job in 1984, you had about 30 years to have a 50-50 chance before that job was considered obsolete. And yet, you had to learn a new skill in order to be employed in the workforce. But in 2014, that's only 5 years. And probably you know that yourself. If you have a job, if you know how to do something, and you don't learn new skills, you don't do retraining, you don't acquire new tools, in a few years, your job is on the line or may never exist again. And in 5 years, the competency half-life will be 3 years. So in 2022, if you don't learn a new skill every 6 months, you'll be out of a job. Or in 2 months, or even a week. Like, this is crazy, but this is what's happening. Because we went from the consumer economy, where we just consumed what the great producers produced, and you were part of a chain. The creator economy, which has created Facebook and Twitter and LinkedIn and Xing, where the value of these companies is actually created by the users. If you take away the users who create the content, the company is worth zero, because there is nothing inside. It's the connections, it's the content created by the users themselves. But now we switch that to what I call the superstar economy. Now, the superstar economy looks like this. And this has already happened in some fields, and I think it will happen in all the fields. So 1% of the top artists in music make 73% of all the profits, 77% of all the profits. And this is in an ephemeralized world where the production of a song can be as high as you want, millions of dollars, or as little as you want, 5 euros. You see homeless people on the streets who have millions of views on YouTube and then become artists who can make a living. The cost of production has gone to zero, but the relative size of who gets what has not changed, in fact, has worsened with the process of ephemeralization, which is doing more with less. So 77% of all the profits go to 1% of the top music creators. And this also applies to global wealth. The top 300 people on the planet in terms of income and properties own 40 to 50% of everything. I mean, it's like the bottom 3.5 billion people. It's crazy, but this is the reality. And this is the picture, the unicorns, the startups, companies that in less than 10 years, they acquire more than $1 billion valuation. And we have some examples of this that probably everybody knows. Airbnb is worth now $31 billion, and it's only 7 or 8 years old. Uber is $62 billion. I mean, we throw out these numbers like it's nothing, but think of what $62 billion was 50 years ago. How long did it take for a company to have the infrastructure, the production, the distribution, to get that kind of valuation? It's insane. And this is less than 10 years old. So this is what's happening, right? Old companies employ a lot of people, and the value per employee is very low, as little as $100,000. So if you have to pay payroll taxes and so on, that means that you can't afford to pay a worker more than 50 or 60,000 euros a year, maximum, gross, brutto, not netto, right, if you're Walmart. But if you're WhatsApp, you can pay your employees millions of dollars a month. Because when WhatsApp sold for $16 billion in 2014, they only had 55 employees, which is almost $300 million per employee. So this is what's happening. Newer companies employ fewer and fewer people and are worth more and more and more. And they grow very quickly. And they're valued billions and billions in a shorter and shorter amount of time. How short? Here is the speed of the unicorns. It used to be that it took 5 to 7 to 10 years to get to a $1 billion valuation. But now it's getting crazy fast. And when I say crazy, I mean insanely fast. Jet.com, a real-time pricing algorithm, it's essentially a machine learning gradient descent, the simplest kind of algorithm with some fancy customizations, otherwise it wouldn't have made a substantial difference in the market. They went from $0 to $1 billion in 4 months. That is the speed of disruption. That is that. And if you think that's going to stop, you are delusional. It's going to increase in speed. Because that's not just a pretty picture. This is reality. This is real data. Okay? So Porcher Research, this is WhatsApp taking over SMS. Now imagine your SMS. You are in 2000, you're like, oh, life is looking pretty good. And then it's 2010, you're like, wow, we are so good. And then 2015, you're like, uh-oh. In 2017, you're dead. Who uses SMS anymore? Like, seriously. And telco operators have realized this. And they're really scared of what's happening. In fact, they are buying off everything they can because they can't innovate inside of their own company. They buy the unicorns who would otherwise destroy them. So they go to a unicorn, fast-growing unicorn, and say, here is $1 billion, I'll buy you. Because I don't want you to become the next Facebook who's going to be worth $400 billion 5 years from now, and I'm going to be dead. Yahoo was worth almost as much as Google a few years ago. Now it's worth nothing. The only reason Yahoo is worth anything now is because it has a good stake in Alibaba, which was a startup that it acquired. This is happening throughout the spectrums. Big companies are compelled to die because they can't innovate inside, or very hard to innovate inside. So if you look at the graph more detailed, it's actually a series of S-curves. You have a paradigm that grows very quickly, and then it exhausts its ability to operate, and that's substituted by a new paradigm. So if you zoom out, it looks like that exponential curve, but in reality, it's a series of S-curves. Now, Paul Graham, the founder of Y Combinator, the most important, most successful startup accelerator in the world, just posted this 3 days ago on Twitter. AI could shift the balance of power between countries. Right now, economic power equals population times average productivity. But with AI, the first term could switch from population to population who can't be replaced by software. Now, I happen to agree with that. But essentially, the question is, can a machine do my job? That's a question that a lot of people are asking themselves now. So you've got a machine, and then there is you, and you're saying, I fight with the machine, will the machine win? I think that's the wrong question, actually. Because the question really isn't that if a machine can do your job, but it's, can a person, a human being with the machine, do the job of 9 people? That's the real question, because machines don't have yet generalized intelligence, which means that there is still pre-singularity, there is still place for people to do work, right? Because machines, they can't abstractly generalize problem solving in all fields, in all matters of life. But people can, and people with machines become more efficient than people without machines. And when I say machines, I mean a very, very particular kind of machine, which is deep learning, machine learning, algorithms, the ability to do so much more in such a short amount of time. So with deep learning, maybe you can do the job of 100 people, one person plus good machine learning algorithms. And what if you take it even a step further? And this is kind of the sci-fi part of the presentation. So this is a prototype idea, image of a neural lace, which is essentially something that attaches to your brain, to your synapses, and directly connects with your neurons. Because right now, we are bound by input-output. Right? If I have my phone and I want to communicate with the world, this is how I work, or my computer, I am bound by how fast my thumbs or my fingers can type on the keyboard, essentially. So 200 words per minute or whatever. But I think much faster than that. I can think 1,000 words a minute or 1,000,000 words a minute if I think in concepts. Like, there are concepts that will take you an entire book to write, and it will take you 2 years to write the book, but you had the concept in a fraction of a second in your head. Now imagine if you had something like that, a neural lace that connects directly to your brain, and you can transform that into code or writing, algorithms. So one human being with deep learning algorithms, with a neural lace, maybe not only can that person replace 100 people, but it can replace 1,000 people or 1,000,000 people. So the question isn't human versus machine, but can a human with a machine augmented displace hundreds or hundreds of thousands or millions of people? Because this is what's happening. This is the company of the future. It's small, it has highly skilled people who use machine learning to augment their intelligence, to create companies that are worth billions of dollars in a matter of months or even weeks, and completely disrupt the market. So is it the same old story, or is this time different than in the Industrial Revolution? I think this time is substantially different. But it's also a false dichotomy. Because if you think larger than a single company or yourself, if you think about society as a whole, there is another structural problem which is even deeper. And this is the real dichotomy, I think. You've got a society, any society today, any modern society, is based essentially on two principles. Labor for income, people work so they can get money to live, to buy services, to pay the bills, to buy a house, to go on vacation and do stuff. And on the other side, you have the government that collects taxes so it can pay for its expenditure, support the population in things that the market can't provide for. Now, what happens when you have an economy that looks more and more like this one? Fewer and fewer people that create more and more value. Well, you've got this paradigm of labor for income and taxes that's challenged, because labor for income almost disappears for the vast majority of people. How do you collect taxes? Well, you have to make sure that the people who are making billions are paying taxes, so that maybe you can provide something like an unconditional basic income or something along those lines. But are they paying taxes? Well, not really. None of them. The 18 biggest tech companies in the world are paying essentially zero taxes. So if you've got an economy where a few startups make trillions and trillions of dollars and employ only a few thousands of people instead of hundreds of millions, and none of them pay taxes, how the hell are you going to pay for anything as society, as governments, or for the people who are not employed by these companies? So if you are a big company, and Xing is a fairly big company, you can use this nice little thing. I'm not an expert in fiscal advice, but this is a double Irish with Dutch sandwich. And I'll take some cream and a coffee as well. So you've got an advertiser that pays for an ad in Germany, okay? And the ad agency sends the money to a subsidiary in Ireland, which holds the intellectual property. Well, that's the key component. The IP stays in Ireland. Now, the tax payable in Ireland is 12.5%, which is very low, but still kind of reasonable. Between 12% and 25-27%, it's like most modern countries have something like this. But the Irish company pays a royalty to a Dutch subsidiary, for which it gets an Irish tax deduction, which is a special deal that they have between the two countries. Now, the Dutch company then pays the money to yet another subsidiary in Ireland that has no withholding tax or inter-EU transactions. Now, the last subsidiary, and that's the last part, although it is in Ireland, it pays no tax because it's controlled outside of Ireland in a tax haven like Bermuda. So in the end, you've got something like this. Apple, that made hundreds of billions of dollars of profits and paid 0.005% in tax on its global profits. So we need a new deal, because this clearly doesn't work. Right? I'm not going to tell you that we can change the way the economy works. I don't think we can. I think this is actually a structural way of the economy. I think the picture of the economy where a few startups control the world is almost inevitable. And I don't think we should fight it, because it's meaningless. This is evolution, natural selection of the market. But what we can control is what we do about it. And essentially, it's the relationship between private enterprise and the government and how we live. So I think we need the new deal, a new social contract. And I think that discussion needs to happen on a larger scale, international scale, in fact, because otherwise you use tax loopholes and you just forget about everything. So I think we need a new social contract. And we need to have a serious conversation, because disruption is already happening, and it will happen faster and faster. And I look forward to the questions that you're going to ask in the remaining minutes. Thank you very much, everybody, and have a great day.
Thank you, Federico. What makes you so sure in all you said? Things will happen like
the
this.
Data, really. The data and the trend analysis. Because I made some very specific predictions, and they have mostly come true. I don't know if actually any of this will happen, so I'm not sure about any of this. But I see the trend line, and it seems very likely that this is the direction we're going.
What is your advice for European countries, for us living here?
I think Europe now, I don't want to get too political, but I think Europe now has a serious responsibility to become a world leader in the world stage. Because now the US, Russia, watch out for Russia, China. I mean, I'm sorry, but none of these has a history of human rights. None of these put people over profits. And Europe actually does. So I think Europe needs to be at the forefront of taking innovation in the relationship between the private sector and the public sector so that it can provide for all of its people and to be a shining example for the rest of the world.
We have a question from the audience. Mickey is asking, how do I initiate grassroots digital transformation in an old school company?
Uh-huh. Well, one way is to present the company with a challenge. So ask the comp. So let's say your company does, I don't know, some old school thing. For example, I'm gonna consult with a very big airline. And I ask them, what is the greatest challenge that you're facing in the next 10 years? And then they come up with a few things. And then I say, what about this? Have you considered that? And they're like, oh, no, that's never going to happen. I said, OK, imagine that that were to happen. What would happen to your company? What would happen to your entire industry? And then we go through the thought experiment. And then I ask, how would you solve this problem, the greatest challenge you've outlined right now? And they say, well, we need a budget of $5 billion and research and development and so on. OK. What can you do with, instead of 5 billion, what can you do with 5 million? Can you solve that problem with 5 million? What can you do to change direction in the next 5 years? So these are some of the things that I do when I work with Fortune 500 companies to address these issues really hands-on with teams in a place where we come together and we draw out all possible scenarios, and then we try to find problems for them, for those.
We have another question from Wee. Are you driving digital future now?
I don't think anybody's driving the future. I think we're riding on the wave of the future. It's kind of an abstract thought, but I think technological innovation follows the same pattern as evolutionary biology. So technology itself could be considered as an organism, which grows and has moments of ups and downs, but it follows the kind of like this path of exponential, faster and faster, smaller and more and more efficient, which is what life has done. It took 500 million years to go from multicellular organisms to the next stage, and then for prokaryotes or eukaryotes, and it took always less and less time. And now that we are rewriting our own biology through synthetic biology and genetic engineering, it might take only a few hundred years to create a new species from humans. So I think you kind of ride the future. You don't really create. I mean, maybe a couple of companies are contributing more substantially, like Google and Facebook and some research centers. But even they have no idea. And they're kind of just like scrambling. Because even if you're the biggest company in the world, you're worth $1 trillion. You're still never going to be more than 1% of the entire market of the planet. And you rely on the innovation of the collective community.
Let us give some advices to the audience. First question, what is your favorite work hack?
Favorite work hack? Yeah, it's to sort yourself out, really, and it's really a life hack. Like you have, like before you can change the world, you have to fix yourself. Because if you don't fix yourself, you're doomed, and everything you'll try to do, you'll just make a huge mess. So you surf yourself out, meaning that you ask yourself, what am I good at? What am I terrible at it? What are my goals for the next 5 years? And what are the intermediate steps that I can take towards fixing those goals? And what are the baggages that you have inside? Like when you think about the past, well, you think about the past really for one reason, because you have unsolved problems. Because otherwise, you have just a nice reminiscence, and it makes you feel good. But most people who like think and think and think about the past is because they have unsolved problems. Source yourself out first. That's really my biggest advice for your life hack.
What do you recommend as to the younger people here in the audience for the future?
So it sounds corny, but really like follow your interest, follow your passion. Because nobody knows what the economy is going to look like in 20 years or in 10 years or even 3 years. So if you think, oh, I should do X, therefore, you know, I'll have job security. That's almost always meaningless unless you do something very specific like data scientist or machine learning. Like these are few fields that will probably stay for a long time, but most you really don't know. Unless you do, maybe physicians, like if you work in the health sector, that's probably the only sector that will stay, that will always have a requirement. Because even if we automate 100% of everything that doctors do today, doctors will still exist because they will have another function, which is to help the patient in things that currently we're not doing, like really talking to the patient and being there more as an interpersonal proxy between the fixing of the problem, which is solving your illness, and you. So in general, just follow your passion and be true to what you feel is right and that you like doing. Because if you don't like doing something, you'll do it badly. And if you really love it, you'll find a way to do it great. And if you do it great, you'll be one of the superstars. And maybe there is enough things in the world where anybody can be a superstar in a very, very narrow field. Maybe.
Thank you very much, Federico. Great to have you here. Take care. Beautiful. Thank you. Lovely. Thank you.